द कंप्लीट वर्क्स ऑफ स्वामी विवेकानंदा राजयोगा चैप्टर टू द फर्स्ट स्टेप्स पार्ट टू प्रैक्टिस इज एब्सोल्युटली नेसेसरी यू मे सिट डाउन लिसन टू मी बाय द आवर एवरी डे बट इफ यू डू नॉट प्रैक्टिस यू विल नेवर गेट वन स्टेप फर्दर. It all depends on practice. We never understand these things until we experience them. We will have to see them and feel them for ourselves. Simply listening to explanations and theories will not do. There are several obstructions to practice. The first obstruction is an unhealthy body. If the body is not fit, the practice will be obstructed. Therefore, we have to ensure that we keep our body in good health. We have to take care of what we eat and what we drink and what we do or what we do not do. Always use a mental effort, what is called Christian Science, to keep the body strong. This is all nothing further of the body. We must not forget that health is only a means to an end. If health were the end, we would all be animals. Animals rarely become unhealthy. The second obstruction is doubt. We always feel doubtful about things we do not see. Man cannot live by words alone, however he may try. So doubt does come to us, whether there is any truth in these things or not. Even the best of us will have doubt at some time or the other. With practice, within a few days, a little glimpse will come, enough to give one the encouragement and hope. As a commentator on yoga philosophy says, when one proof is obtained, however little that may be, it will give us a faith to practice the whole teaching of the yoga. For instance, after the first few months of practice, you will begin to find that you can read another's thoughts. They will come to you in picture form. Perhaps you will hear something happening at long distance when you concentrate your mind with a wish to hear. These glimpses will come by little bits at first, but enough to give you faith and strength and hope. For instance, if you concentrate your thoughts on the tip of your nose, in a few days you will be able to smell the most beautiful fragrance, which will be enough to show you that there are certain mental perceptions that can be made obvious without the contact of physical objects. But we must always remember that these are only the means, the aim, the end, the goal of this training is liberation of the soul. Absolute control of nature and nothing short of it must be the goal. We must be the masters and not the slaves of nature. Neither body nor mind must be our master, nor must we forget that the body is the mind and not I the bodies. A god and a demon went to learn about the self from a great sage. They studied with him for a long time. At last the sage told him, "You yourselves are the being you are seeking." Both of them thought that their bodies were the self. They went back to their people quite satisfied and said, "We have learned everything that there was to learn. Eat, drink and be merry. We are the self. There is nothing beyond us." The nature of the demon was ignorant, clouded, so he never inquired any further, but was perfectly contented with the idea that he was God, that by the self was meant the body. The God had a purer nature. He at first committed the same mistake of thinking, "I, this body, am Brahman." So keep it strong and in health and well dressed, and give it all sorts of enjoyments. But in a few days, he found out that that could not be the meaning of the sage, their master. There must be something higher. So he went back and said, "Sir, you did teach me that this body was a self. If so, I see all bodies die. The self cannot die." The sage said, "Find it out. Thou art that." Then the god thought that the vital forces which work the body, were that what the sage meant? But after a time he found that if he ate, those vital forces remained strong. But if he starved, they became weak. The god then went back to the sage and said, "Sir, do you mean that the vital forces are the self?" The sage said, "Find out for yourself. Thou art that." The god returned home once more, thinking that it was the mind, perhaps, that was a self. But in a short while he saw that the thoughts were too various. Now good, again bad. The mind was too changeable to be the self. So he went back to the sage and said, "Sir, I do not think that the mind is a self. Did you mean that?" "No," replied the sage, "thou art that. Find out for yourself." The god went home and at last found that he was the self, beyond all thought, one beyond birth and death, whom the sword could not pierce or the fire could not burn, whom the air could not dry or the water melt, the beginningless and the endless and the immovable, the intangible, the omniscient, the omnipotent being. That it was neither the body nor the mind, beyond them all. So he was satisfied. But the poor demon did not get the truth, owing to the fondness for the body. This world has many of these demonic natures, but there are some gods too. If one proposes to teach any science to increase the power of sense enjoyment, one finds multitudes ready for it. However, if one undertakes to show the supreme goal, one finds few to listen to him. Very few have the power to grasp the higher, fewer still the patience to attain to it. But there are a few who know that even if the body can be made to live for 1,000 years, the result in the end will be the same. When the forces that hold it together go away, the body must fall. No man was ever born who could stop this body one moment from changing. Body is the name of a series of changes. As in a river, the masses of water are changing. Before you, every moment, the new masses are coming, yet taking similar form. So it is with the body. Yet the body must be kept strong and healthy. It is the best instrument we have.